In question number 31, two blocks are given. Both are having same mass 170 kg, but the coefficient of friction for block A and B are different. It is 0.2 for A and 0.4 for B. We want to find the net frictional force between the blocks and plane. For that, simply we'll find frictional force on A, frictional force on B, and then we'll add it. So net frictional force will be frictional force on A plus frictional force on B. We know that frictional force is mu m g cos theta, but here we don't know the value of theta. We know the two sides of right angle triangle, 8 meter and 15 meter, so we can find the hypotenuse. So hypotenuse, let's say it is AC. So hypotenuse AC will be under root 8 square, that is 64, plus 15 square, that is 225. So AC will be 17 meter. From this we can write cos theta is equals to adjacent side upon hypotenuse, that is 15 divided by 17. So frictional force for block A is equals to mu A m g cos theta. Coefficient of friction for A is 0.2 into 170 into g is given as 10, cos theta is 15 by 70. Simplify this, we'll get Fa is equals to 300 newton. Now frictional force on B will be mu B mg cos theta. Mu B is given as 0.4, m is 170 kg, g 10, cos theta is 15 by 17. This will give us 600 newton. So F net will be 900 newton. So option 1 is correct option. Question number 32. A stationary body of mass 3 kg, it is initially at rest. It is exploded into 3 equal parts. Each part will be of mass 1 kg. Two pieces fly off at right angles to each other. Let's say this is one piece of 1 kg. It is moving along x-axis with speed 2i meter per second, and another of 1 kg. It is moving perpendicular it with speed 3j meter per second. The explosion is taking place in time 10 power minus 5 second. We want to find the average force acting on third particle. Average force is mass into acceleration. To find the acceleration, we have to find the final velocity of the part. Here, using conservation of linear momentum, change in linear momentum is 0 as F external is 0. So initial linear momentum of the system is equals to final linear momentum of the system. Initial linear momentum of the system is 0 as initially object was at rest. For final linear momentum, add the 3 linear momentum of the objects. For this first part, mass is 1 into its velocity 2i cap, plus for second object, mass is 1, velocity 3j. For third object, mass is again 1, let's say velocity is v. From this, we'll find v is equals to minus of 2i cap plus 3j cap. Put this value in this equation. So acceleration will be v minus u divided by t, that is minus of 2i plus 3j into 10 power minus 5. Force is equals to mass into acceleration. Here mass is 1 kg, so force will be 2i plus 3j into 10 power plus 5. This minus 5 will go in numerator, so it will become plus 5 newton. So option 2 is correct option. In question 33, it is given that a heavy block of mass M is suspended by a cord C and a string is attached to the lower end D. If we suddenly give a jerk to the lower end, what will happen? Here, as this block is very heavy, due to the impulse or due to the jerk, there will be no effect on this block. So simply, due to inertia of block, it will not move. So string D will break. So option 2 is correct option. Yeah, in question number 34, it is given that a pendulum of mass M, this is a pendulum, its mass is M, it is hanging from a support to a fixed trolley. This is a trolley, it is hanging from this support. This trolley is moving upwards the inclined plane of inclination alpha with constant acceleration A. We want to find the angle of the string that it makes with this perpendicular. Let's say this angle is theta. We want to find this angle theta. For simplicity, we'll apply pseudo force so that this trolley comes to rest. Pseudo force, that means we'll apply opposite direction acceleration. So this force along the plane will be ma. Other force acting on this object is downward direction mg. Divide this force in two components. One is along the plane, that is mg sine alpha, and another is perpendicular to the plane, that is mg cos alpha. Now here in this string, tension force is created. We'll divide this tension force into two components, along the plane and perpendicular to the plane. As this string is making angle with this line theta, this angle will also be theta. So if this is tension, this force will be t cos theta perpendicular to the plane, and this force will be t sin theta along the plane. Now as this bob is in equilibrium, all the forces are balanced. From this we can write t sin theta is equals to t sin theta is in this direction, and ma and mg sin alpha are in this direction. So t sin theta is equals to ma plus mg sin alpha. Same way for this component, we can write t cos theta is equals to mg cos alpha. This is equation 1 and this is equation 2. Taking the ratio, this t will cancel out. Sin theta divided by cos theta will give us tan theta is equals to ma plus mg sin alpha divided by mg cos alpha. M will be common, so a plus g sin alpha divided by g cos alpha. So theta will be equal to tan inverse a plus g sin alpha divided by g cos alpha. This is our final answer. So option 3 is correct. In question number 35, a wedge block system is given. An external force is applied on this system. Because of that, an acceleration is equal to g is produced in this horizontal direction. We want to find the acceleration of block M. For that, we'll draw the free body diagram of this block M with respect to wedge. Let us say this is the inclined plane that is making an angle theta with the horizontal. In the downward direction, force acting is mg. So along the plane, force will be mg sin theta. And perpendicular to the plane, the force will be mg cos theta. This will be the normal reaction on the object. Now, the external force is acting in this direction. We'll apply a pseudo force for simplicity. So pseudo force is acting in the opposite direction of external force, that will be ma naught is g, so this force will be mg. Dividing this force in two components, along the plane and perpendicular to the plane, so this component will be mg cos theta. So along the plane, net force will be F net will be mg cos theta minus mg sin theta. So acceleration will be, divide this force with mass, this will give us g cos theta minus sin theta. So option 4 is correct option. In question number 36, the position time graph is given. Note that position is in unit centimeter. Now mass of a body is 0.04 kg. We want to find the time between two consecutive impulses and the magnitude of each impulse. First, what is impulse? Impulse is the change in linear momentum. For this interval, velocity is constant. From 0 to 2, velocity is constant. At this instant, velocity is changing. Again, for 2 seconds, velocity is constant. After 2 seconds, velocity is changing. So after every 2 seconds interval, velocity is changing. That means linear momentum is changing. That means we can say that after every 2 seconds, impulse is applied or impulse is received by the body. Now, what is the magnitude of impulse? Here we know that impulse is equals to change in linear momentum. That means mass into final velocity minus initial velocity. If we consider this equation, at particular this point impulse is applied. From 0 to 2 initial velocity. Initial velocity can be found by finding the slope of this straight line. Here slope is, this displacement is given as 2 cm, so slope will be 1 cm per second. That will be 0.01 m per second minus, this is initial velocity minus u, and this is final velocity. Impulse is change in linear momentum, that is m into final velocity minus initial velocity. If we consider this instant, at t is equals to 2 second, velocity is changing. This is the final velocity. This slope will give us final velocity and this slope will give us initial velocity. So I will be m v minus u. Final velocity will be negative as the slope is making an obtuse angle. Slope will be 2 divided by 2, but that will be centimeter per second, so 0.01 meter per second. That is final velocity, which is negative, minus initial velocity is positive. It will have same value, 0.01. Here mass is given as 0.04 kg into minus 0.02. So I will be 8 × 10⁻⁴ kg meter per second. We are just writing the magnitude. So impulse is applied after every 2 seconds and the magnitude of impulse is 8 × 10⁻⁴ kg meter per second. So option 2 is correct option. In question number 37, it is given that a balloon of mass m is initially descending downward with an acceleration alpha. In this case, let us write the forces acting on the balloon. In the downward direction, gravitational forces acting. In the upward direction, the upthrust or the buoyant force due to surrounding air, let's say F is acting. Here mg is dominating, so we can write mg minus F is equals to m alpha. Now, when a mass of m is released from the balloon, the new mass of the balloon will be m minus small m. In this case, the balloon starts rising in upward direction with same acceleration, that is alpha. Again, write the forces acting on this balloon. In the downward direction, gravitational force, that is m minus m into g, and in the upward direction, same buoyant force. Here buoyant force will not change as it is given that volume of the balloon is not changing. For this case, if we write the equation, F minus m into g is equals to m minus m into alpha. This is equation 2. Now, we want to find the value of small m. Simplifying this, add these two equations. Mg minus F is equals to m alpha. This plus F and minus F will get cancelled out. So mg minus mg plus mg is equals to m alpha minus small m alpha plus m alpha. This mg mg will get cancelled out. Mg plus small m alpha is equals to 2 capital M alpha. M is equals to 2 m alpha divided by alpha plus g. So option 2 is correct option. In question number 38, 3 block system is given of mass m1, m2 and m3. They are connected by a massless string and external force F is applied. 4 different statements are given. Here the acceleration of whole system is F net external. divided by total mass. Here external force responsible for motion is F and total mass is m1 plus m2 plus m3. So D is correct. D statement is correct. Now if we write T1 and T2, from the shortcut method we can directly write T1 as, first write the net acceleration. Net acceleration will be F upon total mass m1 plus m2 plus m3. Now T1 tension is produced because we want to pull the mass m3, so multiply this acceleration with m3. Now T2 is equals to, again write the acceleration, F upon m1 plus m2 plus m3. Now T2 tension is produced because we want to pull both the masses m2 and m3. So here total mass multiplied will be m2 plus m3. As mass cannot be negative in any value or in any case, T2 is always greater than T1. So C is correct. As C and D both are correct, so correct option is fourth option. We want to find relative velocity, that means velocity of bullet minus velocity of block. Velocity of bullet is given Fu minus velocity of block is U into 1 minus F. So Fu minus U plus Fu is equals to 2Fu minus U, U into 2F minus 1. So option 3 is correct option. In question number 40, force time graph is given for an object. We want to find the velocity acquired by the object at the end of 2t if body is starting from rest. Here we know that area under this force time graph will give us change in linear momentum. So area will give us change in linear momentum. Linear momentum is V minus U. Your initial velocity is U. If we find the area, we can find the final velocity. Now find this from the symmetry of the graph. The area of curve from O to A is equals to area of curve from O to A to B, because your peak value is F0 for both the cases and time interval is also same, T. So this area is positive, this area is negative, so total area will be 0. As total area is 0, final velocity will be 0. So option 4 is correct option. In question number 41, a shell is fired from the ground with angle theta and with horizontal velocity V. At its highest point, it breaks into two equal fragments. We are considering that mass of the shell is 2m. It is divided into two equal fragments. Let's say each is having mass m. At this highest point, this shell has velocity u cos theta. Now, after the explosion, one fragment comes back through its initial path. It is following same parabolic path, so it has to have the velocity in the opposite direction and having magnitude u cos theta. Then only it can follow the same parabolic path. We want to find the velocity of this second particle. Again, there is no external force acting on this shell, so we can apply the conservation of linear momentum. That means change in linear momentum is 0. P initial is equals to P final. Initially at this point, the linear momentum will be 2m u cos theta. We are taking this direction as positive. Now P final, mass of this fragment is m and it is moving in the opposite direction, so velocity will be minus u cos theta plus m. Let's say it is having velocity v. Simplifying this, we will get v is equals to 3 u cos theta. So option 1 is correct option. In question number 42, it is given that two trolleys of mass m and 3m are connected by a spring. Now they are compressed and released. They always move in opposite direction. As you can see, they always move in opposite direction. And m comes to rest after traveling distance s1 and 3m comes to rest after traveling distance s2. We frictional force between trolley and surface is same, so we can ignore it. What is the ratio of distances S1 and S2? We want to find the ratio of distances S1 and S2. In this case, there is no external force acting on the subject, so initial linear momentum was 0, so final linear momentum will also be 0. So we can write m1 v1 is equals to 3m v2. So v1 by v2 is equals to 3. Now we know that m is coming to rest after traveling distance s1 and 3m is coming to rest after traveling distance s2. Stopping distance v square is equals to u square plus 2as. Final velocity will be 0, initial will be v1 square is equals to 2as1. Same way we can write for second object v2 square plus 2as2. From this we can write s1 by s2 is equals to v1 square by v2 square, but v1 by v2 is equals to 3, so v1 square by v2 square will be equal to 9:1. So option 4 is correct option. In question number 43, it is given that there is a truck with an open end. A block of mass 40 kg is kept at 5 meter distance from this open end. This truck starts with acceleration 2 meter per second square in this direction. We want to find at what distance from the starting point does the box fall the truck. That means when the box falls off from the truck, what is the distance traveled by this truck? That is we want to find. Remember, we want to find the distance traveled by the truck, not the box. Here coefficient of friction is given as 0.15. First we will find the time taken by this box to fall off from the truck. For that we will apply pseudo force. This is acceleration 2 meter per second square in left direction, applying pseudo force in this direction. So for 40 kg block, this force is acting in this direction. This is 40 into acceleration 2, that is 80 newton. In the opposite direction, frictional force will act. Frictional force will be mu into normal reaction. Mu is given as 0.15. Normal reaction will be mg. Mass is 40 into 10. This is 60 newton. So F net on the box will be 80 minus 60, that will be 20 newton. Now time taken by this box to cover distance 5 meter under the action of force 20 newton. For that first we'll find the acceleration. A is equals to force divided by mass 40, that is 0.5 meter per second square. Now box will start from rest. S is equals to ut plus half 80 square. Distance traveled before falling off is 5 meter, initial velocity is 0, half, acceleration is 0.5, that is 1 by 2 into t square. So t square will be 20, t will be 2 root 5 second. Now in this 2 root 5 second, we want to find the distance traveled by truck. Again, truck is also starting from rest. So for truck, u is equals to 0. S is equals to ut plus half 80 square, u is 0, half, acceleration of the truck is given 2 meter per second square into t square is given 20. So S will be 20 meter. So option 1 is correct option. In question number 44, a hemisphere of radius r is given. The coefficient of friction between particle and surface of hemisphere is mu, that is 1 by root 3. We want to find the maximum height up to which the particle can remain stationary. Let us say the particle can remain stationary at maximum height up to h. Particle is at this position. At this point we can draw the tangent. This tangent is making an angle theta with horizontal. So the radius which is perpendicular to this tangent will also make theta with vertical. As radius and tangent are perpendicular and horizontal and vertical direction are perpendicular, if this angle is theta, then this angle will also be theta. Now at this point, if object is stationary, then At this point, if this particle is stationary, then we can consider this case and compare it with the case of inclined plane. This theta is maximum and that is angle of repose, and we know angle of repose tan theta is equals to mu. From this we can write tan theta is equals to 1 by root 3. So mu will be, theta will be 30 degree. Now in this triangle AOB, cos theta is equals to AO adjacent side upon hypotenuse. So AO will be R minus R cos theta. So from this AO will be R cos theta. From this diagram, this whole distance is R. So height h from the ground will be R minus AO. H will be R minus R cos theta, that is R minus R cos 30 degree. We know that cos 30 degree is root 3 by 2. Taking R common, 1 minus root 3 by 2. So maximum height is R into 1 minus root 3 by 2. So option 2 is correct option. In question number 45, it is given that a block of mass M is sliding down with constant velocity v. The angle of inclination is theta and coefficient of friction is mu. In the second case, the same block is projected upward with same velocity v. We want to find the distance traveled by this block on this surface before coming to rest. Here this object will come to rest under the action of two forces. One is gravitational force and another is frictional force. To find the frictional force, we must know the value of mu. For that, we will use the data given for this case. Here, this block is moving with constant velocity. That means the forces along the plane are balanced. In downward direction, the force applied will be mg sin theta. And frictional force applied is in the opposite direction of motion. That will be mu mg cos theta. Both the forces are balanced, then only object can move with constant velocity. So I can write mg sin theta is equals to mu mg cos theta. From this we can see tan theta is equals to mu. Now for this case, this block is projected with velocity v in upward direction. In the downward direction, we will write forces acting. One is mg sin theta. And in this case, as object is moving upwards, the frictional force will act in the downward direction. Frictional force always acts in the opposite direction of relative motion. So frictional force mu mg cos theta will act in the downward direction. So F net will be mg sin theta plus mu mg cos theta. Putting the value of mu is equals to tan theta in this equation, F net will be mg sin theta plus mu is equals to tan theta, that is sin theta upon cos theta into mg cos theta. This cos theta and cos theta will get cancelled out. Mg sin theta plus mg sin theta will be 2 mg sin theta. So retardation provided by these two forces will be 2 g sin theta. We want to find the distance covered by it along the plane. So we'll use third equation of motion. V square is equals to u square plus 2as. As object is coming to rest, final velocity will be 0. Initially, it is moving with speed v. V square. As it is retardation, minus sign will use. 2 into acceleration is 2g sin theta into s. So v square is equals to 4g sin theta into s. So distance traveled is v square divided by 4g sin theta. So option 1 is correct. Thank you.